Hello, we're meeting today for the second time we're seeing. I would like to ask you, can you tell us more about your background in your education about architecture and what you're doing in China?
Yeah, I'm glad to see you again, and then we will have some new topics. And then, but before that, I'd like to everyone know me more. In this map in China map, you can see I'm from the city like southwest of China, the city called Chengdu, and the meaning of Chengdu is the place become a capital, become a city. And this name actually lasted for 2,000 years without changing name. Even, you know, 1,000 years of Chinese history, the politics and then the kingdom change, but the name of for the city never changed. It's really amazing. So I have lived in this city for almost 9 years. I really like there. And before 9 years, I was studying in Canada and England. I also worked in Canada as an architect, and mainly focused on landscape architecture. So with overseas background, I really want to have new ideas for architecture, and even not only for architecture. Before I went to England and Canada, I studied architecture in Chongqing. It's also the southwest, the biggest city in China. And then I moved to down the south, the new city called Shenzhen, by Hong Kong, only a river by Hong Kong. And I moved there and worked there for 8 years for architecture design. And the city, maybe some people know, it's really new because of Hong Kong for 1997. It will come back to the country. So before that, since 80s, the central government decided to have a called a special economic zone. So Shenzhen is the best model for the government at that time to have a new modern city. So Shenzhen is really totally new. It started from a very small fishing village, become to be the biggest cities, one of the biggest cities in China. But after 9 years living there, I don't really enjoy it there because it's totally new without history and without, some sense, cultural sense for me, for my design life. So I decided to go somewhere else, but then I think I have studied architecture and work as architect in China for so long. I want to go out to see what happened. Especially at that time, we in 80s, 90s, we think modernism, like in architecture, important, like with technologies and then contemporary idea. So yeah, many of my friends, like for architects and artists, like to go to the West to learn new ideas, to experience new things. So that's, I am a part of them. So I studied in London in AA school for master degree, and then I went to University of Toronto study in landscape architecture for master degree. It really changed me. Even I have so many experience like as an architect in China already, and then I have a master's degree also in architecture in China, but when I went to the different countries to learn things differently, I find, the thinking, the way changed. But surprising me is, after 5 years study and working overseas, I miss my culture. I feel like Chinese culture is so important for me, because before I leave China to go to the West, I feel, I want to study new things, I want to have new things. I didn't realize, like, I don't, Before that, I don't really enjoy like Chinese traditional
mm-hmm.
buildings like wood structure or temples, because I think it's getting too normal for me. I have no sense with them. But several years like overseas, I feel deep in my mind and with my blood, I feel something like ask me go back. So
mm-hmm.
2004, I went back to back China. But you know, many Chinese, they study overseas or work overseas, they will go back and then they go to mainly go to Beijing, Shanghai, Shenzhen, and then like a big city to go to some famous architecture firms, or they have their own business or something. But for me, that moment, I didn't want to go to big cities or to contemporary modern city like Shanghai, Shenzhen, such a city anymore. I like to go to very local place because I miss something really Chinese and the local. I think it's a kind of identity I want
mm-hmm.
to have.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I choose to go to Southwest. That moment, Chengdu was not so developed and going so fast. So it's quite local. And I was there, I was very happy with the city, the lifestyle there. And then maybe here it's some postcard can have some sense of this city. And this postcard actually is not about city, but it's a dam for like water system. It's for irrigation mainly. 2,200 years ago, it was done by, you know, two guys. One is his father, and then the other one is his son. So two generations with local people to finish this great like water system. And this water system from the west of Sichuan province, because my city is the capital
mm-hmm.
of Sichuan province, then the water system cover all the province from the beginning
mm-hmm.
of the river, and it's like a fence. Start from the dam, the water run from the mountains, from ice, and then become water, and then go like a, really like a fingers to cover the whole basin. Because
mm-hmm.
Chengdu is
yeah.
a basin.
Yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. And it's still working, and they only
yeah.
repair it? How
it is still working.
Fantastic.
Yeah, 2,000 years later, it is still perfectly
mm-hmm.
working. The, and mm-hmm. since the dam finished, it never had like a flood.
Mm-hmm.
And then cover like a thousand of acres of the land, the
mm-hmm.
rice field,
mm-hmm.
and all because of this irrigation
mm-hmm.
system
mm-hmm.
works very well. And then there's
mm-hmm.
so big a population down there. They all have this water for their life. So if you go to visit Chengdu, visit Sichuan,
mm-hmm.
this, I think for any architecture students, and if you're interested in such like a system, yeah, it's best place to learn from like a very
mm-hmm.
old technology
mm-hmm.
for that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also the province I am from, Sichuan province, is famous with this. You know
yeah,
that
bamboo.
Yeah, bamboo.
Most beautiful. Building material.
Yeah.
Because it's growing so fast, like 20 centimeters a day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
It's growing very fast. And also China is the home of bamboo, because the
mm-hmm.
whole country cover a lot of, you know, bamboos with hundreds of different types of bamboo. So some bamboos beautiful architecture material
mm-hmm.
and some bamboos beautiful handcraft stuff. So, yeah, you need to
mm-hmm.
learn different types of bamboos.
You told me about the different sorts of bamboo.
Mm.
There are some of them, they are having more sugar and in other
yeah,
ones. Can you tell
yeah.
me some more information about?
Yeah, like in China map, you can see bamboo mainly covered down the south. Because
mm-hmm.
in the north, it's harder to have bamboo with
yeah.
the cold weather. But down south, we say they're, you know, east and west differently. In the east, the bamboo, the type of bamboo, like especially by Shanghai, they are smaller, but they have less sugar, and then it's good for do the weaving to have fences and have you know, some even insulation for buildings, and then it's very strong. It's it's easy to control, and then in the west, in Sichuan, there are also so much like kind of bamboos, but down to Yunnan. Also, I'm having project there. The bamboo, they call the big dragon bamboo. It's so big and
big,
very tall and very thick with the the trunks. It has a lot of sugar, so that's it's not easy to get them to be architectural material. You need to get rid of sugar, otherwise the the ants will eat it. Have problem.
And it breaks easily, if I understand.
Yeah, it also crack easily. So with bamboo, we still need a lot of technology to develop them. And then also, like yesterday I mentioned, like people use bamboo to do experiment as steel. Because with the tension it has, it can play as even like steel. So imagine in future, if bamboo can replace part of a steel, so our architecture will be more organic and ecology. Also, bamboo is easy to grow and they grow up quickly, and also very beautiful for landscape. And because of bamboo, Sichuan is the only place in the world to have pandas.
Pandas,
pandas. We have like 1,100 pandas left. 70% maybe 70% are wild. So I also work with some NGO institute. They cover the big forest to take care of, you know, the environment to help a panda to survive. So I know a little bit about the places like pandas, wild pandas, but I never see. I touch their shit. We are so excited that wow, there's a panda, wild panda's shit is already dry. It's maybe 2 months ago they left. We have no chance to see real wild panda. It's really hard to meet with them, but you know, people really. Chinese really proud of pandas. We try to give them more,
beautiful.
You know, beautiful place to live. And also such towns, this town is very famous with feng shui. It's a very typical feng shui model for settlement. It's already, I think, almost, I think, 800 years old, maybe more than that. And so around my city, there's so many like such old towns, and they all have their own story about how the ancestor, the first you know, group of people, when they go there, mainly like by the mountain, by the river, how to deal with the environment to develop the population. And then these all like about the lifestyle in the city in Chengdu. Cause
a lot of bamboo furniture.
bamboo furniture. Yeah, you have a good eyes, you find. This furniture is still very popular in the city. Even it's so rural furniture. It's very cheap and then simple. But it's just, you know, very local. So such like tea places. And then these restaurants, and then also tea places, and then some, even they have a kung fu with a tea pot.
Oh, can you tell us more about the kung fu tea?
Oh yeah, more about kung fu tea. Actually, tea houses in Chengdu is very important. It's like a cafe or coffee places in Europe. Like people every day, they spend a lot of time in tea places, and they have a tea with friends or even with someone they don't know, but then a cup of tea, maybe only like less than 10 yuan. Mm-hmm. It's very cheap. They can stay there for the whole afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's really important social life. And then that's why I like the city, because it's quite laid back. They have their own lifestyle. They really care about, like community.
Yeah.
It's social not like Shanghai or Shenzhen. Mm-hmm. People just so busy, and then they only can sit down for 10 minutes and then they say, oh, I have to go. I have work to do. I have a go here, there. But in Chengdu, even they don't make much money, but they are happy with what they have.
Mm-hmm.
They just, choose what the life they can. So that's really not so much happen in China now. So Chengdu is famous with such a lifestyle. And it has been several times to be top three, sometimes top one, the best place to live in China.
Beautiful, you see, because yes, of the quiet life there.
Yeah, I'm lucky. And also with the people there, because of their life getting slower, so they have some fun. This teapot is interesting because this stuff is so long. So let the water go a little bit longer than usual teapot.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are several reasons, like because usually you can see in the tea house, so many people jam together, crowded, and in some village, the tea house is really small. So people, local people, they sit one by one, and then the servants, like in the tea house, they want to give you hot water. It's not easy to go one by one. Maybe they give you the water from far away, so use this teapot like water, know, like a...
It's a fantastic innovation for the tea house.
Yeah, yes, it's about distance.
Yeah, fantastic.
And the other reason, I guess, with this longer, how to call that? I don't know. The
pipe.
Yeah. Okay, pipe. The water... Because it's really hot. And then from here, maybe getting a little bit,
less hot.
Yeah, less hot. And then also it will help the guy make the water precisely go the direction.
Yeah.
Rather get it's too short and then we go somewhere. But it's long and it's more concentrating. It's really amazing. Such things have a lot in Sichuan. With local people, I think they have their wisdom for their everyday life. So I really, really love this very local Chinese stuff. Like you said, the furniture and then, beautiful,
porcelain.
Blue, porcelain. And also such like a natural material tea house or restaurants open to the landscape. And, it's just a really fantastic lifestyle. And also, this is the couple, they make local food. And this local food is like something sweet. But it's not only make food, it's kind of a performance. It's make the sound like a play drum. Because they threw the bowl of rice, and then it jump to the steel plate, and make like a dong.
Sound.
Dong.
Yeah,
dong. So... I don't know, if you are too busy, you run into your business, you will never have such a thing. So for me, I think life can be slowed down, then you maybe have more arts.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. I don't know if you want to share something, maybe, I think living in your country have a similar things.
For sure. The first story... it has to do something with bamboo. You have bamboo in China, and we have in Poland a plant which was forbidden for the last 40 years, and which is growing also very, very fast. And this is industrial hemp. And hemp is growing like 4 meters within 4 months. And it's fantastic. You can produce like about 20,000 different materials from it, and you can use it for medicine, production of the oil, production of the different sorts of medicine. But And you can use it for textile industry.
Mm.
But we are using this for building industry, building reasons, because the hemp sheaf, it's about 80% of the plant, is very suitable for use for building blocks, mixing with lime and water, and you're getting material which is better than concrete, because within 1 month lime is passing process of carbonization, the walls of the building could stand for hundreds of years, and our ancestors, they knew this technique in Europe. Actually, it was very popular. They were combining this with wooden structures, and we forgot about in 20th century. It was forbidden because of drug policy. It has nothing to do with industrial hemp, but still it's the same plant. And the hemp is coming back to Europe, and I hope within the next few years we will have material which could change our pollution, because it's the same like bamboo. Bamboo is growing so fast, it's using CO2 during the process of growing process. Hemp the same, and both of those materials, they could replace steel, they could replace concrete, they could replace so many materials which are during process of production being problem for our milieu problems, for pollution. And I organized 2 years ago a workshop in Poland about building with hemp, and from this time I could really see the interest in hemp building is growing, and we're starting this year many projects, and people are very interested in alternative way of building.
Yeah.
For bamboo, we have just a big distance to China to get some bamboo here.
But so I don't know, for bamboo, I think if the climate is okay, maybe try to plant them. It's one way to go. And then when you say this, I might like to share some something also I have done for local villages. And then with this stuff, I like to say something about out of my work in the big city Chengdu, because I'm architect, and also I'm teaching architecture in the faculty of university in Chengdu called Southwest Jiao Tong University. But with several years working in the big city, I kind of needed to more concentrating of natural materials. Like you said, I really found myself like natural material, and also rural architecture, and then, for example, Chinese traditional rural architecture. So then I have a chance to go to another province. Like yesterday I introduced, is a little bit down Sichuan province, because this the city I'm living in, the teaching, working there, is in Sichuan province. And then south of it, this province, very special, is called the Yunnan province. It's down the south. Why it's special? And because the whole China, we say we have 56 kind of different minorities. Like we are Han. Our looking, our dressing, our history about Han. It's kingdom of Han, and then mainly we are most population are Han. But then we have 56 other minorities, like Tibetan, like Hakkas, like Hani, like a lot of Mongolians. But Yunnan province, they have 52. So whole China have 56, and only this province has 52. It's amazing. And because in history, White day has so many minorities because usually in history, the kingdoms, you always like build up their capital cities upper north and in the middle. Yeah, so this center is of China in the history area. They don't really have a capitals down the south. The reason mainly because this is ocean line. It's more dangerous, like invaders from the ocean in the old time, they come easy to come.
Yeah.
So the capital city usually stay in the mainland, inside, like Xi'an. Xi'an is the most time to be a capital of a kingdom. Yeah, six times. Like six capitals, six kingdoms choose Xi'an as capital city. Beijing maybe only three times or less. So this province in the history is really far from the kingdom. It's somewhere remote. So when there's someone or group, they, you know, break the law, the king push them far away to punish them, just let them go. So that's why many guys, you know, they are not in the middle. They are not part of the mainstream of the society. They are pushed here. And also because this ocean line is a kind of a military border. Government, central government send their soldiers to be in the mountains. The life there quite tough because no cities, no civilizations. That's why Yunnan is far from the center. And it is such a heaven for minorities. They just go there, find their place, and then they're not really affected
then
by wars.
You have
wars.
Many rebellious people living there. If they were coming from there for the reason that they should be quiet. But you're very famous because of tea.
Say what happened, the place in Yunnan. In Chinese. Personally, I started this NGO program because as architect, I should do more like architectural design, but also I'm doing teaching. So I think education is important. So that's why I had a chance to have a place in the village. So I have found so many good picture books for local children. The picture books, it's easy for them to get to be interesting to read rather than you give them a lot of words because for small children, for me, I don't think they really need to spend so much time doing homework, writing 100 times of one word. But for most Chinese schools, you know, education system always for my examinations. But for local children, they have such a nature sense. So I think that's good for them to have such a picture book library. This is the local children. They really close to nature. They are different with children in the city. But they have problem they have a big place to go. They can go to, you know, the field, they climb up tree, they go to the mountain. But when they stay in the village, they have nothing to do. So they just wandering in the street, you know. So when we have the library, and then the library became the local children's home. And I wanted the library to be home rather than say, hey, come to read. You should read. Not like that. It's more like for fun. If the books attract you, you read. If not, you just play around. You can have games, you can laugh, you can draw or, you know, do anything they want. It's more like give them creative time and a happy time. Because I think children in China now is so hardworking. They have so many homework to do, so many examinations to do. And while teaching in university for design, I found the Chinese students, when they come to universities, I found their problem. Their imagination, their creation, and then, you know,
mm-hmm.
even like independence is not good enough with their age, their 20s, but they, you know, sometimes I feel they don't have a common knowledge. Even they pass examination very good, they can do a lot of writing or computer work, but except that if you ask them what you have the story of, you know, the world or
mm-hmm.
your design or your creative, your own idea, they just stay there without any thinking. So they say, no, I don't know, like that. And for students, they from countryside, maybe they're more like with nature sense, but in the villages, they seldom have good things to see. So they're not good with color. They don't know which color is, you know,
mm-hmm.
they match more beautiful. Because in the village, you don't have such an environment or chances to have arts, to be close
yeah.
with arts. So that's the library I promoted. I started to build up, and then I have several volunteers help me there. So the children really happy to have such good books with them. And then we also have the exhibition for their, you know, drawing,
mm-hmm.
and then to encourage them mm-hmm. to be more confident. And then come back to the landscape, actually, I also played an urban planner there, town planner, and I found the environment in the past several years is quite damaged by first time as a 60s, 50s, 60s, like the central government let people to cut trees to do kind of a socialism development.
Yeah.
They cut a lot of trees, and then it's really horrible. Like 100 years, the local people have the forest in the mountains, but then just 3 years, no more than that, all trees gone. So even now, local people suffer from
mm-hmm.
you know, forest
mm-hmm.
gone. So it's totally changed. And also for such like local culture, like vernacular culture, some elders, they still have their own dressing, especially for festival, they dress
mm-hmm.
more beautiful. But normal life, everyday life, they just like us. Yeah, they don't really have their own customs really
mm-hmm.
maintained well, kept well. And so we try to get the library as a base. We do more for encourage them to see their home to be more beautiful, to find the trees important, like children, they draw trees. They also think trees are really important for their
mm-hmm.
living. And then, so they do this arts, and then they can express their love to their hometown, and then hopefully in the future they have such a ecological sense. And also for many Chinese villages, it's very dirty. Like they don't have a really good habit to like disuse the, especially children through the plastic bag and the garbage
mm-hmm.
everywhere in the streets, and then the drainage, and then the water system really dirty. But we have such activities with children, try to clean their place, then they become better, and then we
mm-hmm.
grow up flowers to make this village more beautiful. And then also we have some artistic activities, like children to draw on the wall and then have more pictures. Like you said, this place is a tea place, like in Sichuan, and especially in Yunnan. This place in Yunnan is the home of Pu'er tea. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
the Pu'er tea,
yeah.
I think many people know that, it's like a cake.
Of course.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's a very famous. But this area, the people, local people, actually still living on tea.
Mm-hmm.
Each family, they like have their field of tea, and then each year they really dependent on their incoming of tea. Mm-hmm. But actually local families, they have their tea and they sell to some buyers. It's very cheap, so they don't have enough money of planting teas. So we have some activities. This children family from city, they have such a life in the experience in the countryside, and then they experience how to take a tea, and then they know what happened there. Also, as you just mentioned, like natural materials, like for example, this is the bamboo, and then this is the earth ram the wall or clay bricks to build up the very natural material building. So such activities we also have there, and then attract children and family from the city to be there, experience like how to make by their hand, to have natural materials to become a structure and then become a building. So in this way, I think education for architecture, not for me, is not limited at university in a classroom or in front of a computer. I more like children or university students, they can go to the site and then they do the real things, play mm-hmm. with real materials, and then for there you can learn from local architecture to see how local people deal with the stuff, and how local people they do with their buildings.
Actually, this architectural education should start much earlier than in the university. A few years ago, mm-hmm. it was very interesting research done by one of Dutch universities. Mm. They were following children, they grew up in the cities, just mm-hmm. with parents working, both parents working and all day with computer or with TV. Mm. And children, they grew up in small villages of just outside of the cities. And the children, these children were spending most of their time playing around in the nature. And in this research, it was very clear that the children, they are playing in the nature, they are much more creative, they can manage, doesn't matter what kind of education they get, they can manage much more easy their life. Mm. And they are, they could adapt to the different situations, and the creativity is much, much higher.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's really happen in China now for many parents. They realize their children grow up in the city, they don't have a sense of where the vegetable from or how the building can stand up, how the materials can be. They never know, so they get lost. So now, like for example, we have such events, and then a lot of city, like families in city, they're interested in.
Yeah.
They say, wow, we like our children to know what is real happen. And then like you said, it really helps children to release them, to be more creative.
You are being a fantastic example for in other cities. And we're coming back to the idea of co-housing, living. Living outside of big cities. Yeah. Which is a dream for many, many people, only it's difficult to realize.
Yeah, and except that we are doing in a library for children, but actually, more important for myself, my dream is to deal with the community, the local community. Like this time, I'm so happy to be in Poland for the conference. At the University Rostov, and then Technology University, and then the topic is reactivation of local society, its habitat for habitat, and actually I have done many projects. There was you know, communities, like build a plan for the new buildings in the city, and also do village plan for such a local place. I found even you are architect or planner, you start doing good work, but it's not mean the work will be finished or will be realized in a good way. You need, like, for example, for me, I need to have, you know, the local government have the same value, support, and I have the developers, like, go with you. And important also, like, for local villages, people in the village, the community, they can understand you, and they can give you good suggestion and work with you.
We have exactly the same problems in Poland, because we could be a bridge between communities and local governments, but then we need cooperation. And local government is very often the same problem in Poland. They just don't want to cooperate because they don't see the difference we're making for the local community.
Yeah.
And it's big. Yeah, we just exactly the same problems and exactly the same issues, and we could solve the problem, because if you want to become architect and you are successful in a way, or less or more successful, you have to cover so many topics, you have to be so
strong, and we need
actually we're moving in like, that's why I start to when I start to study feng shui, I understood that, and this is also the point of being architect in history, in European history, in Middle Ages, or even in ancient Greece, people, they wanted to be an architect and decide which way the building has to be done. They had to study medicine, because it's combined with human life, is combined with human needs and safety and psychological problems. You can solve them, you can make them worse, because you're creating the space where the living has to go on. And we are in this time, we just involved in social problems of communities. And I think that I like the topic of the conference very much, and I hope it will not end with the conference. It has to go on, and we have to look for the better cooperation with local government.
I think when you did more like architectural works, then you, I don't know, for myself, I feel it's like getting more like feel the work more than architect. So you're more like a dealer, more like a teacher and a helper with the society and with the government, with the local people. For example, this place for the library, actually many of my friends asked me, why you're a university teacher, you're an architect, why in the city, why you go there to have a rural library? I say, actually, I like to have education in rural countryside for children. That's the dream already have maybe more than 10 years. But why suddenly I have this chance? Because I went there first time as a town planner. I did a master plan for this area because this village wanted to be a tourism place. The local government looking forward, the money come in, help them to make the place to be tourism place. So we're maybe the sixth group, because in the past many investors went there and then they left. Then our group went there. I have a partner's work. I'm in charge of design. But after design, I found that there are more problems than planning. Because if you really make this beautiful, like with 666-year-old like a minority village to be a tourism place in a tourist place, if the design damages this environment, if the tourist development changes the local life, lose their culture, And I'm not a good architect, right? I will say, you did a bad thing. And then I don't want in my life to say, I did a bad thing. Mm-hmm. So I realized it's not just a planning, urban planning. It's mainly about how local people have their own life. Because we are from outside. We go there, we invest the money, make a business of a tourist, and then we left. We get money left. And mm-hmm. how about the local people? What do they get, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And then, so that's why in this lecture, I like to go to the topic I made a lecture for the conference. Mm-hmm. It's really something for myself. Sometimes I really confuse. And I also like to have such a topic. Like, for example, you said it's not only China. In many places, like in Poland, also happen. Mm-hmm. So, you know, tourism development may be going to many places in many countries. It's become the big industry, right?
But except countries as Italy or Netherlands or England, everywhere they have the same problems because local governments and developers, they're just afraid of natural materials. They would like to build everything with concrete, and they damage old buildings. That exactly the same happening now in China on a bigger, much bigger scale than in Poland, because we are a smaller country. Yeah. But I could see that even old people, they rather burn their wooden house.
Yeah.
And they got angry if I'm telling them after all that it's much bigger value than the piece of land you're getting after this burned old monument house. And they don't understand at all that old buildings and wooden buildings, they have such a great value. Mm. And that, I'm happy that I could spend 20 years in Holland and I was involved in monument projects. And, and I could see how big difference makes if the society is much better educated, like in Holland. I mean, not everybody, of course. Yes. And not everybody likes old buildings and antique. But then they understand how important it is to keep their national heritage. Yeah. And that's we don't have it in Poland. In China, it now the same process is going on. And buildings are disappearing, which could change the value of those places because tourists are coming to see old buildings, not the concrete modern buildings.
It is actually really key point for me now recent years, because I have spent 2 years working with local people, but it's really hard, like you said, you let them know, keep their old house, and then it's better for tourists, but they say, I don't want the old building, you know, damp, and I don't want to put money to repair them. I prefer build up a new house with more rooms. Yeah. You know, make more money for business.
Are we dealing with a political problem? Because if government is not going to sponsor and not putting money in monuments and trying to save local heritage, then we can't do anything because the money rules the world. Money rules the world.
it's hard for only architects to do that, because even we have a technology, let them to do, but also because of this technology to repair old building maybe cost more than to build a concrete new building. So that's the problem. And also, like you said, the education of local people, they think, you know, they follow something wrong, they think that's right. For example, this topic in China, they have the modes, like models, I will show you later, like several kind of models for developing countryside to be tourist places. Mm-hmm. And other villages or countryside, they just follow the model. They say, that's the right. If you want to do something different, they will doubt you. They will not trust you. They will say, okay, that's not the way to make money.
Yeah.
So I don't know, maybe we go through a little bit about what
it's
happened.
Very beautiful presentation.
Well, briefly to see the problem I found in China recent years for the tourism development, maybe you can see something also here, because yesterday we went to the beautiful village. Yeah.
Lanzcorona.
Oh, Lanzcorona. Mm-hmm. I like it. I'm a foreigner, I don't really know the farmhouse.
Yeah.
In the past. But when I just went there, suddenly I see the old building and I realized like there are so many stories mm-hmm. about them. I can see the old wood structure and then the typology of the building, the big door for horses mm-hmm. and then, you know, small house because people at that time, they don't have enough money, but they want to have a good location. So you can see the whole like a settlement to tell a story mm-hmm. of the history. So I really think it doesn't matter you are know the culture or not, but building architecture is the thing they can tell the history.
Yeah, of course.
So for tourism also in China now people know like to travel not only for casual time shopping mm-hmm. and at the beginning people just travel for shopping, you know, Chinese famous like go to Paris, yeah. go to Manhattan, just spend money buy expensive mm-hmm. stuff, but getting more and more Chinese people they realize travel is a kind of education, is for study, learning, for their, you know, even like getting fresh,
yeah.
like have
fresh
a thinking,
ideas, yeah,
yeah, fresh,
mm-hmm.
more like that now. So tourism development in China also shift from just, you know, sightseeing, mm-hmm. become more cultural experience. Mm-hmm. So in this way, I hope like more people or local government can support the, you know, architects really do something to protect like historical buildings, like you said, monument buildings.
They need us, but they don't
they
know
need
this.
Us. Yeah. I think maybe we are joining the process. Well, I'm kind of still optimism mm-hmm. To see in the future we're getting better, but now it's really hard for us, but we still need to, you know, keep on
yeah.
going. Like, doesn't matter to do small things or, you know, mm-hmm. bigger things. But coming to China is really big things. For this map, you can see the color. It's mm-hmm. about your urbanization, how like, happened in recent 10 years or 20 years, the urbanization
mm-hmm.
from 45, 40-something, percentage to 53% last year. So for China, it's kind of a transforming from agricultural country become a, you know, no.
Industrial country.
Industry
yeah.
or urban, more urban, you know, urbanization mm-hmm. country. But the central government used to push urbanization by developing, you know, for construction, for urban stuff. For cities, but then they realize like if we only just build up cities, it can be something wrong. For example, like we talk about the ghost city in China.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the government just decided okay, we build up a new city. Then they build up a new city with the plan of 100,000 population.
Mm-hmm.
So they just put money from the government, from bank, from developers, and they build up thousands of units of housing. And then sometimes they sell it. The market is not bad because
mm-hmm.
people also think, wow, this new place will become a city.
Mm-hmm.
And it's better to invest now. For
mm-hmm.
example, 3,000 mm-hmm. yuan per square meter. We buy it and then 2 years later it will become double price.
Mm-hmm.
So in China, a lot of people have some money they don't want to put in the bank, they wanted to put it in housing
yeah,
as an investment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But then the ghost city, why it happened? Because nobody
lives there.
Nobody lives
there. Yes.
No population. The city is come out in a desert.
Yeah.
It's nothing. You know,
yeah.
it's not from people's requirement, it's from the government's plan.
Mm-hmm.
They do the plan, but there's no people.
But you know, I think they didn't use feng shui by planning, because yeah. if they do this, and what I could see in Poland very often, because I used to look for location for the shops in all kinds of commercial centers, mm-hmm. those big ones, mm-hmm. big commercial centers built everywhere in Poland nowadays, mm-hmm. and I could see that every one of them, each of them is designed with feng shui principles, mm-hmm. and they are done this way that they getting you can get as investor, as owner of the big corporation, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. you can get a lot of money from the investment. Mm-hmm. But this is not what I could see, like from 2004, the different way of placing buildings, mm-hmm. and most of them they are having main entrance from the south, mm-hmm. and main entrance from exactly south is bringing a lot of money, mm-hmm. for the investors, mm-hmm. and for the owners of the building, mm-hmm. but it's creating very bad people energy, mm. there's bad relations, and the people renting the space, they're not earning enough, mm-hmm. and very often nowadays this principle is used, mm-hmm. that the direction south is bringing money for the owners of the investment, mm-hmm. or for the investors, not for the for those people which are using this place. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's the same story with those ghost yeah. cities, something wrong was done with planning, because otherwise people would like to live there. And it's all about money.
Yeah, I agree with that. There's one reason for the central governments from top to bottom, it's around. Second, once it starts to do the urban planning, they do wrong way, like you said, maybe too crowded, and they don't have enough green space, they don't yeah. have beautiful, you mm-hmm. know, sense for living there, it's more functional, or you know, yeah. it's for the government to show their yeah. you know, show their achievement, rather yeah. than say, oh yeah. that's what it is good for yeah. people,
not
to
human scale.
No yeah. human scale, yeah, I think mm-hmm. that's all problem. So, but come back to the tourism happening, so urbanization, like with the new city, that's one way the Chinese government to go for 10 years and found that there's a problem. You know, they couldn't have more ghost cities, because we yeah. already have several many ghost mm-hmm. cities. And then it's a show the government to say it's the wrong direction. Mm-hmm. But recently they find a transform, like countryside or villages mm-hmm. to be tourism. Can be good urbanization, because they transform the countryside population to urban population. You know, mm-hmm. they don't need yeah. to go to new place, build up yeah. a new city, and wait for people to move in. They just transform them, and also transform countryside place to be tourist place can make a lot of money for local government, for facility improvement, mm-hmm. also for local mm-hmm. people to have income increase. So you can see those diagram, you can see the incoming mm-hmm. from tourism is really getting yeah. fast. So that's the way in China, like thousands of towns and villages there developed tourism. So you can see, you know, mm-hmm. 500 old towns. Some towns yeah. have, you know, 800 year old or 500 year old, transforming to be tourist areas. Mm-hmm. But this kind of movement have done for 10 years. But mm-hmm. till today, my research will show there's still, mm-hmm. you know, some problem happened there. Mm-hmm. The problem happened is, like I said, Chinese like to follow. If someone say this way is right, or government mm-hmm. say, I hope you guys go that way, or encourage developers go that way, and that they all go that way. They think that's a safe yeah. way. Mm-hmm. That way will make have the government mm-hmm. support, and they can make a good money. And this picture shows the very famous town called Lijiang in Yunnan, and because after an earthquake, they rebuilt the old house with but they used like wood, and they mm-hmm. used old way to rebuild, and then transform, make of use of this chance, they transform the old town to be very famous tourist spot. So with this model, and a lot of towns follow this way, and in the end, 10 years later, they are all pretty same. And you don't know where you are, because they're all like shopping business streets. I think when I traveled in England, I went to some little towns. I found the pretty same problem.
Yeah.
Like they always have one main street,
mm-hmm.
like with a lot of shops. And then I went to different, villages or towns, and I confused whether I have been here before or not, because they're pretty same.
This is a problem of local product, of local identification. If we could keep trying to develop real local stuff, then we could see the difference between those cities.
Yeah, so local, and I don't say it's global, but whether this used to be very local place can still be local, that's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So when we talk about local, I like to go to talk about, you're doing research for feng shui. Because feng shui really, really about, the site itself.
Yeah.
It's not about somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
It's about where the place is, and where the mountain is, where the river is, right?
Mm-hmm.
And where the place should have the settlement is. So it's not something be away of the place, it's down to the place. So this is, I really think feng shui can have designers back to see what's the elements for design from the place, rather than you have your idea, or you have some models borrowed from other place, and then just put on your design. So this is very familiar to you?
Yeah, of course. It's the first image you're getting when you're trying to follow the workshops. With different masters, and it's the model situation for a good localization of the city. Also for the graves, but if you want to bury somebody who is very important, then you also look for a similar place, but then the directions should be different.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a lot of common sense in this way of placing buildings and placing cities, and it's the same. It's the same story I told about European geomancy. It was very well known in Europe as well, in other cultures. Only we don't have enough evidence about this knowledge being used for placing the cities.
So the image here, I think this is a feng shui model you mentioned, and then this is Chinese painting. I like a Chinese painting. I just think it's mainly about art, about emptiness and with something you draw. But now I'm more like learn from the Chinese painting of the environmental idea, about the life philosophy of the people, Chinese people in the past, how they deal with the nature. Because here you find in Chinese painting, I checked thousands of Chinese paintings. The building always is small, and then they are part of the landscape. Chinese painting is famous with beautiful landscape, rather than with
buildings
or people themselves.
Yeah.
More about the mountains and the waters, and then the clouds. About rocks like that, trees. So I think that's a really important and also different for modern people now, also for designers, because people now the more they deal with buildings, they want to build a lot of buildings, and then for local people I talk with them, they just think about how many rooms I can have. Each room can make money, and how many rooms I can, they just use their land without any emptiness. They just want to have as more as places for business. I tell them, don't do your building so high, maybe just keep two stories. And they don't want, they want to have three stories because then they have more guest rooms.
Yeah.
I say then the quality will have problem, and then tourists maybe don't really feel happy. And you get lower, you have less room, but you can have more expensive for each room.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really hard to communicate mm-hmm. with them.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes I have this image, I just think maybe in China, the people now, they should have every day they have their Chinese, old mm-hmm. Chinese traditional painting mm-hmm. on their
mm-hmm.
wall
mm-hmm.
to have this sense
yeah.
education say, we should change our attitude
yeah.
towards
yeah,
yeah. the world. And also this old village, 1,000-year-old village, really beautiful about how people with harmony with the nature.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Balance
it's they jammed together, they control the size, they don't, you know, easily to expand, they keep the water, rice field, the mountain to be themselves, and then they control themselves. But when we see the development right now, it's really expanding from the villages, they build up like more and more building and take, you know, agricultural land and cut the mountains and cut the trees, so that's really bad. So what we found like in the history, like a courtyard
mm-hmm.
building is very dense. It's about the density. Population in China never be small like compared with
mm-hmm.
other countries.
Yeah.
It's always a lot of people, especially in the east. Yeah, around the river, there's so many people live together. So they have such architecture typology, so courtyard that they can jam together,
mm-hmm.
but they still
mm-hmm.
have a green open
mm-hmm.
space inside. So families, like generation by generation, they can share the space. They still have doesn't matter courtyard or atrium, how big or small, or how big or how small it is, they still can have a fresh air and the trees there. So they keep this kind of typology, really deal with Chinese 1,000 years settlement history.
Very friendly way of living for people.
Yeah, it's friendly,
yeah.
but also it's a very good solution deal with
mm-hmm.
density.
And for social problems, of course.
Yeah,
yes.
like a social, like you can see here, it's very dense.
Mm-hmm.
They
yeah.
jam together, but even that inside, you still have, you know,
mm-hmm.
you know, sharing and the social space, and also
mm-hmm.
with nature space. So also like China is agricultural country in the past 1,000 years deal with you know, this is a terrace for
mm-hmm.
rice field, and then also it's short in the province in Yunnan for minorities they know how to make the irrigation
mm-hmm.
use the water system to have such landscape but still kind of naturally way. It's
yeah.
not, you know, totally cut the
mm-hmm.
mountain, remove the mountain. So they have their housing, but with the farmland and with the water, with the mountain. So, yeah, that's what we should learn. But with tourism, we absolutely we have a positive aspects. So in China, like with the tourism development, we have become a new industry from agriculture, turned to be, you know, servants,
yes.
service industry
yes.
called,
yes.
yeah?
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
it really helped local people because they made so little money for farming in
mm-hmm.
the past.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have enough cash, they are really poor. But this tourism industry helped them get incoming. And then, you know, new people move there as a service population, so make the countryside with more activities, more dynamic. And then infrastructure, like washroom, like a transportation system, also because tourism developed and then make
mm-hmm.
them improve the situation. And then, but on the other hand, there are some bad things, negative, like because I say there's no control, like as the past or as Chinese painting, give the sense of human beings with nature. So expanding really happened, and it's really become problem to damage the agricultural land. Now the government gave some policy, really try to control. After 10 years, it's lose control, but now it's getting mm-hmm. better. And then, but yeah, the problem with these two, it's like a social problem. First, it's demolished, like you said. Local people, they don't have this education. They don't think that keep old building is efficient or is economics, like saving mm-hmm. money. They wanted quickly to have a new building and make a new business. So this is the problem. That's why we have this library. Maybe it's a little bit take a long time for new generation to realize their things. But anyway, what I can do? You know, when you have no idea, say you can change the people right now. Maybe I say I help their children to have more, you know, good, you know, value yeah. of their own life, of their old things.
Mm-hmm.
For future.
Yes.
That's education. Education never can be in a short term to
yeah.
to have something happen, but
mm-hmm.
you have to prepare for future.
Yeah.
And for future, the children grow up and then they know more about what's beautiful, what is more valuable, what's kind of
mm-hmm.
Their own identity, their
mm-hmm.
own culture. So that's
yeah.
one thing. And the exclusion really happened, very social things. And then even for this word, I think I can talk for many hours, but
yeah.
you know, it's a so different topic about, maybe it's not only architects, like the solution, but it happened in China, like a local area, turns village, turn be tourism. There's one way, several ways, like investors push them away,
yeah.
or give them money, or build up a new house, let them move
out. The law of the strongest.
Yeah. Another way, like there's more people realize move people out is not good. They let them stay, but local people, they decided to go by themselves. Because
yeah.
they found if I rent my place in the center, I move out, I have
mm-hmm.
more cash, so I can make money. So that's something change. Like now many places in China, the villages, you go there, you find there's fewer local people. There's all tourists, like you're a tourist, you're
mm-hmm.
someone from outside to open business. And then you seldom can see the local life there.
Yeah.
So the village we visited yesterday, I think right now it's nice. People still living there.
Yeah, of
now.
Course, but then there is the same process going on, because there's a lot of rich people trying to buy a house there, and they coming once a year, and those houses are empty.
And
it's the same story.
Out.
The same story, sold out for the rich artists. Or, yeah, exactly the same story going on in Landskrona.
Yeah, we don't know, because it's a social issue. Our architects don't know what to do.
We can only discuss the problem and give advice, but who is going to ask for the advice? This is the problem.
Yeah, and what I'm doing now is not for architects' work, because, for example, a library keep like local children there, and then the tea we made by ourselves to try to cooperate with local villagers, sell the teas and help local people in order to get money and then move out. And we try to have some incoming for them to stay there. I don't know, it's modern architect's work, but for market, architecture work, maybe we say we try to keep the old technology to repair the old building. It's kind of keep the building first and try to keep the local people.
Yeah,
that's some way. So yeah, like the model shows, usually they have landscape old village, and then at the beginning they repair some old building, But sometimes they just have more new building inside, sometimes damage the whole atmosphere. And then there's another way, like build up a totally new settlement beside it. So maybe the local people move to the new place and they have this place for tourists. So in China, they usually do this three kind of process. And then they all have their own problem. You know, repair, sometimes they couldn't do historical remain in the right way. Mm-hmm. And then if we go expanding or making new buildings, sometimes the modern building with old building is mixed, is not good, go well. And then new built up buildings, the quality usually very bad.
That's what we know in Poland as well.
It's boring and then bad quality. Mm-hmm. They just quickly move people to be there, and it's not totally not good. And then during conference, I share four cases as typical cases about a different way to develop. The first is the red one for government, the black one for investor. So this kind of government, you know, control this from top to bottom for developing. And then, because government couldn't do investment in China, so they have to work with, you know, some developer. And it is totally, you know, investment, like a, you know, more like a commercial or marketing place way. And it is with local, work with local, in the investors work with local, and it is more like individual, NGO or intellect or very personal, like work. So there's several kind of cases to show how it works. This is in the East, and this is really successful in some way because this investor didn't push local people away. They let them stay and help them to run their family business and encourage them to keep their old buildings. But the condition is this village very well well maintained, so the quality really good, so easy to go with it. But this one is another case, like this island used to have nothing, and someone like famous artist had two housing there, and then get a lot of artists or kind of try to be artists. The businessmen from all from the country go there to build up so many guest house, and all the guest house try to take the water line. So they just
ugly.
They, you know, one by one to take all the water line. They don't care about the.
We have in Poland, this, actually in Krakow, a discussion going on about taking the line of the Wisła River. I mean, not trying to stop the developers to build on the water line, because this makes the city much nicer for people, for tourists, if you can access the water freely. Here you can't.
It's a lost control. Actually, the really lost control. Even some water line, you couldn't go because be blocked by some guest house. You have to go there and then you stop and go around and come back to the water. This is something for tourists is not good for planning. But also the worst thing is the drainage. The first, it's just go to the lake, without enough clean. So that's even more worse, like a problem for this place. So now it's like people at the beginning, they really want to go there because there's so romantic atmosphere, very nice lake with, you know, blue sky. But then now people, tourists realize that this is a horrible place. So that's the case should give us a warning. If you don't control, then in the end you will lose. That's the story. And this is from government, top to bottom, actually such a kind of a model is took like 60-100% of small villages tourism development. And then because with the government background, the money no problem to go there, the investment always have something going on. And then for part of the time, it's people like, it's quite popular. There are a lot of events going, but still something missing.
Yeah.
Why? Do you know?
Just local, yeah.
It's local. Not really local, yeah, because it's from top to bottom. Still with something missing, I found it's missing human sense. Like,
yeah.
It's not so creative or fuzzy, it's more like some models, like
mm-hmm.
like such a thing, such a village, you go to once, you go to the other one, also the same model,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They really same.
Yeah.
They copy like
mm-hmm.
such
mm-hmm.
such a things everywhere. So in the end, you feel this such a place mm-hmm. boring. So that's the problem. And this is the case like from bottom up. It's really very personal. This guy, one or two.
What's the name of the place? Bishan.
This Bishan is in Anhui in the east, a small
mm-hmm.
village, but also with very old buildings. And then he's famous like artist like for exhibition.
Mm-hmm.
And then he with several poems and writers together bought some very cheap pig's house
mm-hmm.
and then turned into be
oh yeah
guest house.
A very famous story.
Yeah?
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm.
And then they had a lot of art activities there, then really intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is they are too intellectual, they are very
mm-hmm.
high level, they have activities there, even very local, but still, you know, elites, like, you know, for small groups.
Mm-hmm.
So local people didn't feel it part
yeah.
of them.
Yeah.
They're still not
yeah.
a part of them.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I'm doing a library, rural library in the village. I try to not go that way. Because
yeah. yeah. Yeah.
you're too far from villages, then some people even challenging this guy, say, you are invaders.
Yeah.
You go there, you take a chance of the village,
yeah.
and then you do your own art
yeah.
stuff. And then, but anyway, it gives something different to the village.
Mm-hmm.
They're
not integrated in the village.
Yeah, not
enough.
Maybe they can do better.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I always follow the case to see what they have done good, I can learn. And maybe sometimes they go too far, I should also
mm-hmm.
be careful. So... yeah, that's for technologies, and I think you are really involved in such technologies.
Mm-hmm.
Like also you recommend some workshop for me. Like I think in Europe, especially in Netherlands, in England, in Germany, they have a very good
mm-hmm.
Developed technology to prepare.
Also in Slovakia.
Yeah,
yeah,
also Slovakia. I think
Czech
even
Republic.
Here, maybe there's some.
It's starting. It's starting very slowly.
Starting slowly. Yeah, such like use like nature or traditional way, but you need update with modern
mm-hmm.
Modern methods. Yeah, for example, this ramped wall.
Mm-hmm.
They have foam inside and they use steel frame to
mm-hmm.
to do their circle walls rather than use like wood frame
mm-hmm.
or make the wall too thick to get
mm-hmm.
the insulation. So it's more updated and very efficient because it's steel.
Mm-hmm.
So after this wall, they can redo it. Yeah.
Remove it.
Yeah.
Easily. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And then Chinese local architects also, they try to combine modern and with very local material
mm-hmm.
like bamboo, like wood panels, and even like paper, and with steel structures, try to mix them, become
mm-hmm.
more innovated
mm-hmm.
Vernacular buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much like some question and
I like this presentation and your research very much because you're showing good examples and we can learn a lot from this.
I think so, I'm more throughout the questions because for myself, I think my practice there, I still need share like informations or mm-hmm. even you guys can go to China. We have a workshop or seminar, and like for example, I did go to Germany to see how greenhouse or architecture going there. I wanted to green school in Indonesia. But anyway, in the end, I have to go back to China to mm-hmm. the village to work with the local people and to see what kind of way they prefer on the I can do and also with our budget. So,
yeah, thank you very much. It's a really great presentation and a great topic for us mm-hmm. because we have so much in common.
Yeah.
And I hope we can meet in China next time or in Poland for the workshops and seminars.
And I really think your place, your plan for education center and you're doing right now is really good for many people, especially for us. Like we are trying to do such experimental things in China, but I wanted, start, with a higher level rather than from the beginning.
Course,
you don't waste time. You can have mm-hmm. more people share the information, like your education center. If you finish, start, mm-hmm. I will have my colleagues and the Chinese teacher students come to mm-hmm. to be here. Yeah. To learn.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
We need
I
to
hope.
Learn.
Yeah, it will happen soon.
It will. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I hope like in Poland you can get more support because you mentioned like you are not you are fear of people mm-hmm. in Poland to encourage mm-hmm. Such like nature material architecture, green architecture, ecological architecture, and also even like transition town with such ecological idea. I hope like you can have more your people work together with you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I hope so as well. Yeah. See you in the future in the education center, which would be completely finished in 10 years. And I will come to visit your center.
Yeah,
I think we covered many topics for today and I hope we will have such a discussion maybe next year. And thank you very much for listening to us. Barbara Wojtkowska.
And Yin Hong, thank you. And I also hope you can go to China to visit different cities and then especially go to villages because in China, villages, they keep very local culture and architecture and with a lot of wisdom for local housings. So we'd like to share more there.
Okay.